We were living a perfectly normal life until my son developed a lump in his neck, and I took him to the doctor. He was 13, and I took him on Friday, and when he went in, he had a pea-sized lump, and the doctor said he didn't like it. He wanted to biopsy it, and he set up he scheduled it for the following Monday. By Monday, it was the size of a golf ball, and they removed it, and that night he called me, and he said, "Carmen, it doesn't look good," and he was crying. And he told me it was non-Hodgkin's at first, which meant he would be dead in 6 months.
We lived in New York at the time, and my mom was having to transport my brother back and forth to his chemo, and we kind of had a live-in babysitter while my mom and my dad were taking him to the hospital and getting his treatments and stuff.
I remember my brother was really sick. You know, at the time, I didn't have an inkling of how sick he really was.
There were times when I was alone, when he was in the hospital. The nerves were so raw, but being the mother of four, you can't allow things to defeat you. Because it's not just yourself you're fighting for. We were having to drive 306 miles round trip a day. He was very nauseated after the treatments, and then the traveling made it worse. And he wasn't eating regularly, so he was dropping weight extremely quick. And I was afraid that the trip and the treatments were going to kill him before the cancer had a chance to.
You know, they were just a blue-collar family trying to make it. And it was pretty expensive from what we remember, and I just needed to get closer to where he could have his treatments.
So I discussed it with my husband, and we decided to rent a place in Connecticut closer to the hospital where he was being treated. And in doing so, I was having trouble finding a place that would rent to four children. I had passed an old colonial with a for rent sign. Well, I stopped and I went upstairs and looked around, and it was a very nice house. I was impressed. I didn't think there was any way I could afford it. And I contacted the landlord, and it was affordable. He agreed to rent to me, and I was ecstatic, and we went home and got prepared to move.
When I first came in the house, my brother was showing me some of the weird things, like the room where they made the headstones and the footstones and the body lifts, and that's kind of how we were putting things together, that it was a funeral home.
When we first discovered it was a funeral home, I went to the landlord and I discussed it with him. We would have lost the money we put down for a deposit in the first month's rent, had we have backed out.
The house across the street used to be Hallahan Funeral Home. It was Hallahan Funeral Home when we moved in, and has been since the 30s, maybe earlier.
The Hallahan family owned the house as long as I could remember. They had the funeral home. They lived upstairs. Very, very nice people.
Well, I worked in all the funeral homes in Southington at some point in time. I'd get a call to go in and do a corpse's hair and makeup.
He needed help occasionally to go retrieve bodies from the hospital morgue. And he came over once in a while when I was around, and he asked if I could take a ride with him in the hearse to go pick a body up in the morgue.
When you walked to the bottom of the stairs, there was a big open room, and it had a counter that went completely around the room. That was the south coffin room. That was my bedroom. And the north coffin room had big metal pipes sticking out of the wall, and that's where the coffins were placed, and those were the more, I guess, expensive coffins, and they were on display for people to purchase. There was a storage room off to the left. You walk in that room a little bit past the furnace, and there was a blood pit in the right corner that went down, and that's where, back in the day, when they embalmed people, they would have on a table above it, and the blood would drain down into the pit. There was a bigger room, and that's where the coffin lift was, that actually they lifted, after they put the bodies in the coffins, they lifted them up through the floor to the display area.
When we started to move in, I went there with Matt one time just to let him pick his bedroom. The kitchen had a really nice cobblestone tile floor, and I went to put the mop to the floor, and the water turned this deep red, and it was thick, and it had a putrid smell. And there was a carpenter woman still in the house doing some crown molding. And I went and got her and I said, look at the floor, I don't know what I'm doing wrong. And she kind of squatted down and looked at it and left and never returned.
My family had kind of, my parents were going through a divorce, and just Aunt Carmen was always, through the years, kind of like a second mom, and she knew that we were going through hard times, and she just called, and it was set up that fast, you know, just come up and stay, we've got room, great.
The house was, all in itself was scary looking at it, a very scary feeling when you walked in.
They were living there full time, and my dad was commuting on the weekends. He would come in Friday night, stay till Sunday night, and then he'd leave Sunday to go back, be back at work Monday morning.
Me and Matt were very close. He took me downstairs into the mortuary, and we kind of hung out on the gurneys down there. There was a separation from upstairs to downstairs. The basement always had its own feel, its own emotion.
Immediately, Matt heard his name being called from the basement the very first day in there. And he told me that. And I was concerned, knowing what was going on to his head and neck, that the medication, the treatments, were causing him some mental issues.
When we first moved in the house, it was pretty much the same way it was when we lived in New York. Me and my brother got along great. You know, the family got along great. And me and my brother started telling my parents stuff that was happening in the house. And my parents didn't believe us. And my dad would get mad at my older brother, saying that he was putting stuff into our heads. And my brother started to get a little bit more withdrawn as we lived there longer, because he was seeing more and it was affecting him a lot more than it was affecting me.
He had a journal or a notebook that he would write poems and letters and notes, and just he would jot anything down, and a lot of it was really dark and enough to make me go to my Aunt Carm in regards and worry. Within weeks of being there, I was already pretty upset and worried that Matt was not doing well.
But you know, as a mother, you expect your teenager to start going through that stuff about that time. And I knew that him having to face his own mortality at a very young age could cause him to want to live fast, thinking that he wasn't going to live another year. But his personality continued to take a darker side.
He had gotten pretty mean and just started attacking Brad constantly.
Just leave me alone!
It's okay. I remember having to break them up in fights, which would cause fights between me and Matt.
He was always fighting with my sister or picking at the kids, you know. We tried our hardest just to stay away from Matt. That was the best thing for us.
Take you for a ride.
In the movie, it shows my brother spinning me on the morgue table. We were just joking around, and we were actually playing hide and seek. And I laid down on top of it and was gonna cover up with a blanket, and he grabbed me and started spinning me. I started getting scared, and I started, you know, getting flashes of things, and I asked him to stop. He didn't stop right away, but he did stop.
He was going to a priest once a week and a psychiatrist once a week, trying to help him through those issues. And I was hoping that it would just be something we'd come out the other end of, just like the cancer treatments.
There were a lot of things that I saw down in the basement. There were entities that would appear.
Me and my older brother were showing her different parts of the downstairs storage area, and we were going to take her into where the coffin headstones were made. And you look down, and there was this gentleman in a long gray jacket, and he was completely gray. And when he turned to look at us, he had no eyes. They were just like black, dry sockets. And he took a couple steps to us and then just disappeared.
We called them black apparitions. In the corner, on the ceilings, constantly moving lights.
There was orbs we'd seen in the house that would float around the house, and they were gray in matter, and they were about this big, and they were completely see-through. It just looked like a wisp of air or maybe cigarette smoke, but it was perfectly cylindrical, and it would fly around the room, and it would disappear. It'd go straight to a wall or go straight to the top of the ceiling.
You could see something that twinkled like a lightning bug, and then it's a full person standing in front of you seconds later.
It was also a little shadow figure who used to hide in one of the corners, and he'd play games. He'd stick his head out and you'd kind of see him and you'd disappear. But it wasn't like a shadow, like a person shadow. It was a shadow where you could see that it looked like a person, but you could see through him.
The ghost stories continued to escalate. And first it was one, then it was two, and then it was all the kids. And they would see things like a woman in the room. Then there was the little boy. Little black boy about six in the Superman pajama.
He used to come out in the south coffin room, and he'd come out of the left wall and fly around the countertop.
He was always in his pajamas, and he seemed lost and scared. He just wanted to go, you know, be safe.
I think that he was just trying to play because he was a kid.
I saw him, but I never really had an interaction with him, but the younger kids spoke of him sitting there and playing with toys, or he would take a stuffed animal and tell them he was going to bring it back, and he would bring the stuffed animal back, and if it were a bunny rabbit, it would be missing its carrot, or he would always keep a little piece of something that he, any toy he took, he would keep.
I didn't believe in ghosts. I believed in God, and I believed in the devil, but I believed that the devil was someone that put bad thoughts in your mind. I didn't know he could reach out and slap me.
There was another night when me and my brother were awoke in the house, and I had one of those little remote control robots, and there was three guys standing over by our dresser in long black trench coats, and they were messing with the robot. And my brother said something, and the robot just went flying across the room and hit the wall and broke, and they were gone. So me and my brother started screaming, and my dad came down with a shotgun.
I saw a broken robot and a few toys that were smashed.
And he believed us on that point because the robot was actually laying on the floor broken. So he couldn't say it didn't really happen.
Brad never mentioned anything about ghosts. He never mentioned anything about noises, weird things happening.
I used to sleep in the house. I was, you know, me and Kim, we hung out there all the time. You know, we used to roller skate in their driveway and play in the basement, and they never let on that there was something going on in the house.
Going to school with the kids, you would think you'd hear about it in school. Maybe if Brad didn't share it with me, maybe Brad would have shared it with a schoolmate.
Late night sleeping over, you know, girl talk, you know, you just would have thought that something like this would come up.
Those type of things don't stay secretive when you're 8 years old.
That was very hard for me to deal with as a child. I mostly just tried to block it out and didn't want to talk about it.
I recall some incidents, but at that age, you know, things can be altered in memory.
We used to leave the bedroom lights on downstairs in the basement, and of course that caused the electric bill to go through the roof.
When my husband saw the electric bill, and everyone was sleeping with the lights on, he just removed the lights out of the basement where the boys were sleeping.
Well, after he pulled the bulbs out, one night I was laying in bed and my sister came down the stairs. And she started flicking on the light switch downstairs. And I said, "Sis, what are you doing? You're not supposed to be down here." And I got up and I chased her up the stairs. And I chased her into the living room. And my dad and mom were sitting there, and they said, "What are you doing out of bed? You need to go downstairs and go to bed." And I said, "Well, where's my sister at? She just was downstairs turning the lights on and off." And they said, "No, she's in bed. Go look and see for yourself." And I walked in there and I looked, and my sister was sleeping, and I was walking by my dad, and he said, "Well, quit messing around, because you know I took those bulbs out anyways."
There were crucifixes on both sides of the door jamb that had been there for many, many years. They were discolored, and you could tell that they'd been there for many years. They started disappearing one at a time. Most of the activity stayed in the morgue until those crucifixes disappeared. And as they disappeared...
That
scared the crap out of me.
How can that possibly have just happened like that? Are you okay, Carmen?
I'm fine.
It didn't hit you?
No, it just scared the crap out of me.
Something is really cold in this room. I want to get out of this room right now.
Okay. We're giving recognition. This kind of thing happens. The best thing to do is get through it as quickly as possible.
Okay.
And then everything will go back to normal. My husband didn't believe that there were ghosts any more than I did. He thought it was mainly Matt's fault, that he thought that he was inciting the stories.
Before my parents believed the stuff that was going on in the house, we tried everything we could to make them believe that what we were saying was true. There was just no tangible evidence. We couldn't take a picture because we didn't have cameras. You know, we tried recording them on little kids' recordable things, and people would say it's just static.
No, I didn't think there was anything wrong with the home. I thought something was wrong with Matt, and I put him in a mental hospital. And that was when another hurdle that was very tough they came with an ambulance and took him away. And then when we got there to the hospital, they put him in a cot that was basically a straitjacket in a room the size of a closet. And they were going to shut the door, and they wouldn't let me speak to him or be near him. And they said, "You have to leave." And he's screaming, "Mom, don't leave me. Mom, don't leave me." And the last thing he said is, "Now they're going to come after you." Shortly after I had Matt put in the hospital is when things escalated.
There was a man that used to appear in my room after my older brother moved out. And he was one of the more scarier things that I've seen. He was just a head. He had long hair, but he had a wicked scar that came down the center of his face. And this whole side of his face was smooth, like kind of like metal. And he just had a circle for an eye. It didn't have any color, any pupil or anything. And he would just start flying around the room.
I went to the refrigerator, hungry, just searching for something to nibble on. 20 minutes before, it was fine. I went back and it was just rotted and corroded. How does an apple go from being something I just bit out of to being rotted and nasty? I would have never picked that up to eat it because it would have just bled out in my hand.
One night, my niece Tammy came into the room and she said, "Aunt Carmen's happening again." The curtains flew up, and as I pushed her back, I could see the perfect imprint of a hand underneath her shirt. All three knuckles, the bone from the wrist, the outlines of the fingernails.
It was like a thousand hands just in wind and just voices and just horrible noises.
And I called the church, and they said, "Say the rosary and call me in the morning."
And we commit to doing that, and I'm wearing the rosary as a necklace as I did constantly, all day, every night.
And it engulfed us, this black cloud is what I call it.
And the rosary beads just lifted up.
It lifted, levitated off her chest, and shattered.
These are the rosary beads that were lifted off of me, and this, I still have my rosary. I keep it with me everywhere I go, and it's in lots of pieces. But it's still very special and has a power in it.
So I ran into the bedroom and jumped on the bed, and I told my husband that the house was haunted. And I called the Warrens in the meantime.
My name is Lorraine Warren, and along with my husband, Ed, it's over, well over 50 years that we have been investigating the paranormal, the supernatural, and the preternatural throughout the world.
They're the only people that I had ever heard of that did this kind of thing.
And where do you go? You know, you can't just look in the yellow pages and find a ghostbuster or a demon fighter. You know, you have to put it out there to get help.
Somebody that I worked with had an article with their phone number on it, and I called them that night, and they said that they'd be out the next morning.
I had worked with my aunt and uncle, Ed and Lorraine Warren, and at that point in time, I was one of their key researchers. They had called me and told me about this wild case that was going on, and would I join them? So I went over with them, and they were interviewing Carmen and her husband and some of the events that were occurring in there.
When we went in the house, you could feel what was going on there. You knew you were in a home where haunting phenomena was very prevalent.
How can a funeral parlor be haunted? Nobody died there.
A lot of people have asked me why I didn't just leave the house when things got really crazy and I understood what was going on. Well, there were several reasons. One, we couldn't financially afford to just run off. And in a home, there is security and safety, even if there's chaos inside.
But we were also told that if we just packed up and moved, there was a chance of whatever was in the house could follow us or be attached to us.
Leaving the house never solved the problem. I tried several times to go to the movies, to be a normal teenager, hang out with my friends, and things would happen, horrible things. People would be slapped or moved or touched, you know, and they didn't know, but I knew because of what we'd already been through in the house, and I eventually got to the point to where I didn't want to go anywhere.
We did start sleeping on mattresses and air mattresses in the living room as a community so we could have, you know, white light on us, because when there was a white light present, it didn't mess with us, and we felt safer sleeping in groups.
Which was kind of cool because it felt like we were all camping out and we were all together, so I wasn't as scared.
There were a lot of times that the presence would be so strong, you could feel it. You could be running away from it and it would be in your face the whole time, just that close. You could smell it, feel it, know it was there. It let you know it was there.
It was almost like we were ambushed, is the best way I can describe that to you.
The main one that I really remember was Aunt Carm was in the shower. It was like something was alive in the shower curtain. It was wrapped around her like it was trying to suffocate her. Like I had to fight to get the curtain pulled away from her. And she on the inside screaming and panicking, trying to fight too.
It actually happened to my husband as well. It liked to attack you when you were alone. And the bathroom was the perfect spot for that because that was the one place that you always went alone.
We never again went in the bathroom alone after that. We all had to go in pairs.
Carmen would go under a lot of attacks. We call them psychic attacks, where she would get dragged into this very dark, deep place.
She would just hit the floor, just pass out.
And she couldn't move, she couldn't talk. There was no reactions whatsoever, so I knew she was into something very deep.
There was only darkness, there was no light. And each time it was a little different.
It was like something was trying to take her over or control her or hurt her.
And I ran into different beings that were all suffering from negative emotions.
We would be over her with Bibles and rosaries, crying and praying. Her hands would be ice cold.
And the next thing I would know, I'd be back in my body and things would be, I'd be on the floor. And there'd be people around me saying prayers. And I'd be wet from holy water.
It was like something released. And she was able to get up and talk to us about what had transpired. Would I have called an ambulance thinking that, oh my gosh, something medical happened? You know, did she have a stroke, a heart attack or something? That's always on your mind.
I think that they were the experts in what I was going through. I don't think that a doctor would have understood. They probably would have put me in a padded room.
One evening in August, very hot outside, all the doors and windows were open. Carmen, her husband, and the kids, and everybody had gone to sleep. And I was just jotting down some notes that evening. And it got very cold. Now, we know in haunted locations, our energy gets drawn. Why does that happen? Because the spirit needs that to be able to try and communicate and manifest. Well, I got up from the dining room table, went into this big grand hallway, and this foul smell came over me. Well, I looked up the staircase, and I seen something actually starting to form up there. It started to descend down the staircase. And it said, I don't know if I heard it audibly. To this day, I still don't know. It said, do you know what they did to us? That's what led me to believe that there were things that transpired in that funeral home that just weren't natural. If some of these bodies were being violated and the spirit was still around, how horrifying would that be for that spirit to witness something like that?
You know, when I worked over at the Hallahan home, like many other funeral homes, there's always somebody to oversee that the job is done, that the corpse is respected. So I don't see how there's any room that anything like that could happen.
Finally tonight, chapter two of what some are calling a real ghost story. You may recall our telling you about what some call a haunted house in Southington. Well, something's afoot there again, and Elizabeth McGuire brings us the latest.
I'm still afraid of this house.
Well-known ghost hunters Ed and Lorraine Warren were called in after family members claimed they heard mysterious voices and saw apparitions. The house is a former funeral home. Pulleys that used to lift coffins are still in place. A table once used to prep bodies now holds laundry. Each night for weeks, Carmen has laid out mattresses in the living room, the family and the investigators sleeping together for safety and to keep a close watch on what may exist in this house.
The Warrens encouraged us to go public. Basically, they said that it would get the church in quicker, that the church hated publicity.
Because, see, there's certain protocol where the Catholic Church is concerned. They're just not going to send a priest in. It usually starts with the parish priest, who, in most cases, knows the family.
And I really didn't trust that, per se. But my husband was really getting tired of all the people being in the house. He was coming home from work tired, and there's six people in the house. And he said, well, if this will get it over faster, fine, go public. And that's what happened, and I don't think that he understood the ramifications, I know I didn't, of what going public would do to our children.
When the story first came out, we had to go public. It was kind of embarrassing, and I was pretty angry at my Aunt Carm, hoping there would be other ways because I was in high school.
Things turned really bad. People that I hung out with, you know, all my friends stopped hanging around me. There was a couple kids who actually picked fights with me, and I wound up fighting a couple times because, you know, they were saying that I was crazy, my parents were crazy, and crazy parents cause crazy kids.
Whether or not my parents' decision was the right decision, I support their decision. Whether it was the right decision or not at this time, it's hard to tell.
We never experienced public wrath. We were normal people. We thought normal people would treat us as normal people, but that's not always the case.
I lost a lot of my friends. I wasn't allowed to play with nobody. I really didn't have anybody to play with after.
When you're talking about a six-year-old child having her best friend scooped away from her because she says that, or her mother says that they live in a haunted house, when she doesn't have a clue, she's 6 years old. Who's going to hold her responsible for that?
This woman's really not going to make all this up. What is she really going to gain from all this? She's got her hands full with trying to raise four children. She had two nieces living with her. She's working full time. She's dealing with the perspective that she might lose her oldest son. So her interest in making up a whole ghost story was the farthest thing from my mind.
Somebody that would deliberately put their family at risk for any kind of financial gain, they're a waste of flesh.
The family seemed like they were sincere. I talked with them and I talked with the paranormal who was on location. I had never had anything happen to me at the house, but they tended to have an answer for that, that the fact that I was a reporter was the reason why the ghost had never showed himself.
It was kind of hard to believe, not because of it being a haunted house, more that nothing was being said about it until all of a sudden one day. It seemed like the Snedekers were a great family, played together, had fun, everything was going great, and then boom, we got problems and there's an exorcism going on.
I went and got a notebook, put it in my bedroom on my bedside table, and put a pen with it and started writing down whatever was going on at night. So here I have the notes that were taken, license plate numbers and whatnot. I started writing down the goings-on in the neighborhood. And usually when a story would come out in the newspaper, you could compare the journal and the information I wrote down and match it to the story. And things just didn't add up.
This house across the street could be the most haunted house on the street. I wouldn't know it. How would I know it?
The people, especially across the street, never came to the house.
They didn't walk in my shoes. They didn't live in my house. They didn't see my son. They didn't know my son. They don't know me.
Once it was dark out, there were people out there frequently, and it was just disturbing the peace of the neighborhood. At different times, somebody would go up to the windows that were open because it was summertime and go whoo, whoo in the window, or they'd go up and shake the front door.
It was getting to national coverage, and it was becoming a very big circus.
We were at the home approximately, about eight times back in 1988. During that time, we were at the home for, we had a prowler complaint. We had a minor juvenile complaint, suspicious person, trouble with neighbor, harassment, and some type of theft. So there's no ghost calls here, no aberration type of calls.
I had a crush on this guy at school, and lo and behold, weeks later after the story went public, he was in my front driveway and he wanted to come in the house. And Uncle Law grabbed him up, brought him in the house.
Brought him downstairs and said, "You want to see a ghost?" Set him on the coffin lift. And he ran away from the house and never came back.
Kim had came over my house one day, and my mother and father were in the kitchen, getting supper ready. And my dad, as a joke, said, "Oh, Kim, I hope you didn't bring any of your ghost friends with you." And at that moment, we heard the boom, 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 boom. Four chairs fell off the table, and we saw the umbrella open, and the whole table with the base full of stones lift up and gently off the deck. We just kind of all looked at each other and we're like, just really started laughing because we just thought it was, just such a coincidence, such a strange, strange thing to happen.
There was a book written on the case in the beginning. It was called In a Dark Place by Ray Garten.
I didn't want any part of it, and they wouldn't remove any word, not one word that I wanted removed did they remove. I had no editorial rights to it whatsoever. My story wasn't my story any longer once I signed on the dotted line.
we had people coming in droves wanting to look at the book and read it. And the only way we'll allow them to read it is here in the library, and we have to hold identification while they look at it because these copies are rare.
Mm-hmm. It's no longer published because of what he said.
He's made a lot of accusations, and some of them are very hurtful to the family.
I know it's hurt my son, and it's hurt other people. But he can say whatever he wants. He met me one time for less than an hour. He spoke to me maybe a half a dozen times on the phone.
He wasn't really paying attention. He was going back and forth. He was making extremely derogatory remarks, and I had no clue why this gentleman was even reacting like this. It was totally bizarre to me.
He never met my son. Said he was a drug addict. I can't fathom that. I can understand demons better than I can that.
I don't know how we ever got connected with anybody that would say anything like that. I really don't.
He claims that Ed Warren had told him at one point in time, I don't care what you do with it. I don't care what you do, just make it a good, scary story. All these people are crazy that are out there. I find that awful hard to believe coming from a man that dedicated his entire life to this work.
It's more than hurtful because my husband's not here to defend himself.
The one thing that bothers me more than anything is this man was a published author. He already had a few books to his credit, but yet he said we all lied. Then please explain to me why this gentleman did not contact his agents and his attorney and tell them he did not want to put on the front of that book, this is based off of a true story. He came to that point where we knew the church was going to sanction the exorcism in that house. Now, this has been shrouded with so much doubt. People have said, there was no exorcism that was performed in there. I was involved with it. I was involved with the evaluations. I was involved with several of the clergy members.
I can't give you the names, and I was actually had to sign a release saying that I would never divulge the actual ritual. There were three priests and three deacons. There was a strong man and a secretary to take notes.
I wasn't allowed in the house. I was too young. It was too dangerous for me to be in the house or around the house when it happened, so I stayed away with a friend.
They had brought in some religious relics, one of which was a Madonna, and they were placed in various places throughout the house. They spoke the Mass in Latin, in Hebrew, and in English.
During the exorcism, there were several different things that actually had transpired in there. We had rumbling that went through the house.
All the time, it was cold, it was nasty, and it was dark in that house.
Ed and Lorraine Warren was there. Mr. Warren got some chest pains. I was very concerned for his well-being.
And at the climax, it was like it just broke.
The second we said amen, it was like spring showed up in the house.
And that home was successfully exorcised.
But when the ritual was over and we went to collect the relics, they had found that the hands were missing off of the Madonna, and I kept it until 3 years ago when I gave it to John Zaffis, and it's in his museum to this day.
A lot of things in here that I've collected over 36 years. A lot of the items that I have in the containers and the casing and everything is to help protect them. We've done bindings around them so that they can't actually cause any problems. And over here, Carmen, is where I have a lot of the artifacts from your home. I have them on display today. You always try to keep your momentums from a lot of the different cases and different things so that you remember these things. You and I have gone back and forth. We've had a lot of people talk to us about that, Carm.
The actual deacon that brought it in wouldn't touch it. And I couldn't throw it away. And so now it's in your hands. After the exorcism was performed, we waited 6 days to make sure everything was clear, and we moved out.
When we moved down to where we live now, nobody knew us, and it wasn't really talked about.
I was so angry at this point that I disconnected from the Warrens and everyone else, and we just moved to Tennessee, and I disconnected from them all. I wanted nothing further to do with them. I saw what kind of people they were. They wanted to use my story to get their own notoriety.
Tonight's program will be about the haunted funeral home.
They didn't really care what happened to my children, or me, or my husband, or whether we ever came through this alive, dead, or whatever.
It was another case for us. They were a nice family. They stuck together. That was very important. We just moved right on.
My brother, luckily, thank God, he did pull through his cancer. He's got beautiful children. He's got a wife. He travels. He sees the world.
More recently, with the film coming out, there have been cars here from New Jersey, Pennsylvania, New York, Massachusetts, Vermont, taking pictures of the house across the street.
The family and also the neighbors, they appreciate us going by to make sure that there aren't people that are stopping in the middle of the road or on their sidewalks or on their property or what have you. So.
It sparked up a lot of paranormal interest within this community. Some of the people lived here in Connecticut also had their own experiences, and it grew from there.
I think what people are looking for is anything. I think that once there could be a fascination with the paranormal or ghosts or whatever it's going to be, and they want to be able to take a look and say, you never know, maybe we'll see something ourselves.
In going public, we did serve a greater good by getting the word out there to so many people that you're not alone. This does happen. There are resources that you can initiate to help you.
I believe Carmen has convinced herself that there is ghosts.
Maybe they believe that happened. Maybe the Snedekers think that this happened in their home. If that's what they believe, then I'm sorry that they had to go through that, because I don't believe it happened.
I definitely take comfort in not believing. it helps me sleep better at night.
I think that's true of most skeptics. I mean, people are always afraid of things that they don't understand. And it's common to seek the familiar, and it's easier to reject things that might frighten you or shake up your world.
My Aunt Carmen is an amazingly strong lady. She, to this day, lives for this, for people, and has, you know, changed her whole life around to help people.
Her faith was passed on to her children, and I think that everything happens for a reason.
It's an experience that you'll never forget, and it does make you stronger.
All I am doing is telling my story. What you do with my story is up to you. You can call me a liar. You can say I'm a thief. You can say anything you want to about me. It's not going to affect me. I choose to move on and try and understand what did happen to me, raise my children, and live the best life I can live. Because the only person I really have to answer to is my family, myself, and my God.
Thank you.